I wanted to get your opinion on Chicago's new mayor.
I'm not a big fan. You know, he's really, you know, he says, you know, he's about reform, he's about change, but I mean, he's part of the same crowd that's been in there for the last 22 years. I mean, basically, what I think happened was, you know, White House Chief of Staff, that's not something people do for a long time. They burn out after a while, or people get burned out on them. I think people were getting sick of him at the White House, and he basically got transferred to Chicago, and his job is to go there, and his big thing is fundraising. So Obama wants to raise $1 billion for his 2012 campaign, and he also moved his campaign headquarters back to Chicago. So Rahm's there. Rahm's assistant is running the campaign in Chicago. Rahm's old assistant from the White House. So Rahm is going to be his go-to fundraising guy in Chicago. And it was Obama was the one who put him over. He was the one who got him through in the first round, because you saw that. Well, you didn't see that, but there was an ad on TV in Chicago where, it was his White House farewell ceremony. And, you know, they do those all the time. But how often do they film them and have the president talking about what a great job he did and what a great guy he is and what a great mayor he'd make? So that was basically the endorsement ad right there. So they filmed that and they put that in an ad for Emanuel. So everybody got the picture that Obama was endorsing Emanuel. So he ended up doing as well in the black community as he did in the white community. But another reason for that was because of Carol Mosley Braun. You know, they dug her up, and she was supposed to be the consensus black candidate for mayor of Chicago, but she was a terrible candidate. First she said she didn't want to release her, she wasn't going to release her tax returns. And they asked her why, and she said, because I don't feel like it. And a couple days later she did. And then she was in a debate in a church. It was actually Jeremiah Wright's old church on the south side. And she was in a debate. Rahm wasn't there because he hardly ever showed up at the debates, because he didn't have to, because he had $12 million to buy ads. But there was another candidate, she was a minor candidate named Patricia Watkins, and she had recovered from drug addiction when she was younger and gone on to get a PhD and done a lot of good stuff. And she accused Carol Mosley Braun of not having done anything in the last 20 years. And Carol Mosley Braun said, well, you wouldn't know because you were strung out on crack for the last 20 years.
Is this serious?
Yes. And so right after that, Carol Mosley Braun got up and left the debate. And it took a couple days for them to get her to apologize, but she finally apologized.
So it was a circus, basically.
Yeah, so she did terrible. She won one precinct. She won the mini Ripperton apartments.
Okay, this is a copy of Young Mr. Obama, Chicago and the Making of a Black President. This is my book about Obama's early years in Chicago, starting with his arrival as a community organizer and ending with his election to the U.S. Senate in 2004. And it explains why Chicago is the only city in America that could have produced the first African-American president, because Chicago and Illinois have a longer and deeper history of black political empowerment than any other city in the U.S. Illinois has had 3 of the 4 black senators since Reconstruction. Illinois has had more black statewide officials than any other state, and it talks about the role that Harold Washington, the first black mayor of Chicago, played in Obama's political rise. He was a reason that Obama came to Chicago in the first place, because he wanted to live in a city that, where African Americans were, in charge of their own destiny. Live on the south side of Chicago, the largest African American community in the nation. And he really wanted to build a black identity for himself, which he hadn't had growing up in Hawaii.
What? I have some questions. You mentioned the word empowerment, and by the way, Ted, I interviewed him. Well, he interviewed me, or sort of, the first time, like about a year ago or so.
Okay.
We're talking about Flint, Michigan.
Yeah.
I had a question about the word empowerment, because when I think about black people in Chicago, yeah, there's a lot of black politicians, but it's a lot of property.
Yeah.
And it's also not just a black politician, but there's a lot of corruption in general in the city. So.
Yeah.
It's kind of interesting you would use the word empowerment. And
well, I guess here's the thing about. This is the other side of the machine. I mean, one side of the machine is corruption, but the other side of the Chicago political machine is everybody gets a piece of the action. It's built on ethnic coalitions. So even from the very beginning, blacks were part of the political machine. So there was guaranteed that there would be a black congressman, there would be black aldermen, black legislators,
But who owns them? I mean, that's the question I have. Yeah. Because you can have black and Latino and white and whatever type of politicians. Right. But, you know, for example, Obama and McCain, those guys were pretty much, well, the big contributors to their campaigns were British Petroleum and Goldman Sachs.
Right.
I mean, some of this what's stuff, really important to me is who actually owns the guys.
I mean, some of them were controlled by the, you know, white mayors of Chicago. Some of them were controlled by Richard J. Daley. But there was a, you know, a early powerful black politician in Chicago named William J. Dawson. And, I mean, he was kind of a power unto himself. He helped put Richard J. Daley in office in the first place. And who owned him? He was owned by the numbers runners. He protected the numbers runners, and they contributed to his campaigns. This was back in the 40s and 50s before they had the lottery. So these guys had all the money on the south side of Chicago. So who owns them? Who owns Obama? I mean, Obama was, he kind of came out, he didn't really come out of the machine per se. He came out of a lot of independent movements that were founded to counteract the machine, like the Hyde Park independent movement, the Harold Washington movement, and you know, he was kind of considered a good government liberal when he was in Springfield.
All right, so the book is basically about how Obama became president, and
well, it's about not it doesn't go that far.
Okay,
it goes up to when he's elected to the U.S. Senate.
Ah,
so it's sort of his rise through Chicago politics. And it talks about, you know, there are incidents in here, and the first time I met him was in 2000 when he was running for Congress against Bobby Rush. And, you know, he was not accepted by the black community in Chicago at first. There was one of his opponents said he was considered the white man in blackface by the black community. He was considered a representative of the University of Chicago, the white liberals there, you know, who were seen in some ways as having pushed the black community, blacks out of their homes to expand at the universities. There was a lot of suspicion about him in the black community. And so part of the book is how he overcame that. How he, you know, when my mom read it, she typed it, she said a lot of it's about how he learned to be black. You know, how he learned to change his speaking style. Because he was a very poor, stilted, pedantic academic speaker when I first met him. So his advisors said, you know, go to the churches, listen to them speak, listen to the preachers speak. So he started working that into his speeches. And it was interesting to hear his speeches around maybe 2003, because then he was trying a little too hard. He sounded a little bit too much, you know, like a jackleg preacher.
You know? Oh, boy. I kind of want to see that one now.
You can see that. You can see that on the internet. It's up there. You know, it's like almost, it was almost like after everything you expected him to be saying, uh-huh, or someone in the audience out there to be saying that. So he kind of struck a balance, and that's what he's been about his whole career, you know, striking a balance between the black community and the white community. But by the time he ran for the Senate, he was overwhelmingly supported by the African-American.